Haifa Israel, that he got his degrees in physics. And he also did his postdoc work at Brown University. During the last 27 years, he was the department chair from 1997 to 2003. And currently, he's a director of the Laser Institute and also the associate director of the MERCED program. He received so many honors and awards. I will list just a few. He received the 2005 Utah Governor's Medal of Science and Technology. He also got the 2008 ATS Frank Isaacson Prize for Optical Effects in Solids. He is also the recipient of the 2009 University of Utah Rosenblatt Prize. His research deals with organic semiconductors since he started his research here. One of his biggest achievements was in the field of organic spintronics. Mm-hmm. The milestone work was giant magnetoresistance in organic spin valve here at the department, published 10 years ago. Like Valid pointed mentioned to me earlier this week, yesterday was exactly the 10 years anniversary. So this presentation is also in commemoration of the discovery. So let's hear his talk on the progress of organic spintronics in the last 10 years.
This is really a pleasure and probably a fate. I didn't plan it, and so, but when I saw that the colloquium slot is open, then I realized maybe it's something from somewhere. And so it was exactly at the 10th anniversary of this paper. So I decided to put myself expose my the 10th anniversary. So organic spintronics is a title of my talk, but it's a part of MRSEC. We have biology number two in a moment. We'll tell you about it. And this is a paper. It was published on 26th of February. It got already 848 citations as of, I think, Sunday, no? Mike. And it was done here in the department by four people. Xiong was a postdoc from China. Diu was a student of Jingxi, and Jingxi was a professor here. Because of this paper, was so much cited. Each of those people are full professor somewhere else. And Xiong, I think, is a vice president of research at some university in China. And Di Wu is full professor somewhere else, and Jingxi is full professor in Riverside. So the story, you'll see the story later, but what is here, it's a response of giant magnetoresistance of an organic spin valve. And you can see that by switching the fields back and forth, there is some kind of dip and some kind of hysteresis. The blue curve was positive and the red curve was sweeping forward and backward. And so this is a device. It's composed of two ferromagnets and an organic in between, organic layer. And when you change the magnetization of these two magnets, I will explain it later, then the resistance changes. More about the paper. Jingxi came to University of Utah from Motorola. So he was really the expert in spintronics. I was expert, local expert in organic. And so together we formed some kind of a group and submitted a proposal to NSF. And because of this proposal, we hired Sean, and Wu was already here. So Sean came specifically to do this experiment. And we succeeded in I think, half a year. So that's the story of the paper. Okay, collaborators in organic spintronics, that is IRG number 2 in a moment you see from MRSEC. The original collaborators are here, as you see them. And from University of Utah nowadays, the collaborator is Christoph Bohm, Feng Liu, Joe Miller, Misha Reich, Brian, and Ashutosh Tawari. The postdocs that I mentioned their work is Bortman, Chris Caris, Negoyen, now he's in the University of Georgia, Vance Futen, and Dali-san. And the graduate students, some of them are here still, some of them moved away. Fujian Wang, Boj, Basel, Roundy, I don't know where it moves and when, Seagal, and Ryan. And the staff member that was involved was Leonard Wojcik, who is a chemist. From other institutions, originally we got LSMO substrate from China, and Ethan Renfrond, who is now here for 2 months, came from Israel. He's a constant collaborator and friend. And the work, organic spintronics, is supported by the MRSEC here at the University of Utah and an NSF project that I have with Brian. This is IRG number 2. There are 2 groups, plasmonics and organic spintronics, and you don't see names here. Our group is divided into 3. I'm talking only about FRG number 1, which is Focus Research Group. And FRG number 2, I think I gave a talk last year. That's magnetic field effect. And FRG number 3 is magnetic resonance. Christoph Bohm gave a talk last year, I guess. 2013 fall. And so the important thing about this 3 groups and so on, it's not the groups themselves. The important thing is this cycle. And this cycle represents collaboration. This is the main important word from MRSEC. I wouldn't collaborate with so many people if MRSEC was around. And of course, collaboration needs funding. And so without funding, I wouldn't collaborate with those people. And so really, this is the main thing of MRSEC, collaboration. And I'm glad to see that the MRSEC foster collaboration between Dima and Oleg, between Mishenko and Lebok, and others. These are the main thing of MRSEC. And many universities actually envy us. We are 1 out of 25 MRSEC around the US. And many universities would like to have that. So to be a crown of electronic or solid state physics, if you like. Okay. MRSEC also gave us through USTAR a lot of equipment. And this is some of equipment that we can see downstairs. It's an evaporator glove box, an evaporator that we got in April 2013. And I think in chemistry they got a PNMS sample probe, and Joel uses it. So MRSEC is not only collaboration, but it provides also equipment through USTAR. This was very good until now, has been. There are a lot of publications that I won't mention. Some selected publications, organic spintronics, are here. First of all, the main one. And then after that, there are a few FISREV letter and FISREV B. But then in 2010, there was a book that I edited on organic spintronics, and still going on. I still get from this book, I think, about $25 per year, yeah. And I have to pay taxes on that. And then out from the time that MRSEC came to University of Utah, and we have 2 other publications in Nature Communication and Science, so we are still going strong. The outline of my talk is here. You will see the outline many times, because each time that I jump over, I will tell you about it. And for the moment, I want to talk about organic semiconductors. So at the beginning, that means 1977, organic semiconductor was the debut of organic semiconductors. Shirakawa invented transpolyacetylene, and McDiarmid and Higer at that time were in Philadelphia. Shirakawa was was a visitor in Philadelphia, and they could dope transpolyacetylene to very high conductivity. On that discovery, they got the Nobel Prize in chemistry. And so what are the pi-conjugated polymers? If you go to restaurant or to drugstore, you get all kind of organic polymers that are not pi-conjugated. Those are, all the bonds are taken, and so they are saturated polymers. The hybridization doesn't have to be sp3, but all the bonds are taken. There are no extra electrons, so you cannot do much with them because they are insulators. Most of them are sigma bond, and energy gap is 6 eV. Pi-conjugated polymers on that, and small molecules, on the other hand, are such that only three electrons of any carbon atom is bonded. The other carbon atom, it sticks perpendicular to this plane, and it's not bonded. Well, it formed demersion, so it's called pi bond. Those in-plane are sigma bond, and the outer plane are pi bond. And you can see that the pi electrons actually are responsible for the electricity of a property of this pi conjugated polymers, and also for the luminescence, electroluminescence, and so on and so forth. The most important part of those polymers and also oligomers and molecules, this is a molecule that I'll talk about. Those are small molecules. Those are enormous polymers that a small part of them are called oligomers. And they have a very strong luminescence, photoluminescence, most of them. If you take a crystal, solid crystal, and measure luminescence at room temperature, you won't get 60% efficiency. But those polymers have so much luminescence that can make lasing. And today we have a seminar on lasing in polymers. And so that's the main event of polymers, except also that they have a band gap that can be tuned. And so those polymers can be tuned between, in colors, between red to blue. And so you can have red, blue, and green all together, pixels, 3 pixels, and you can have a screen and so on. So this is what happens, what would happen within 10 years. This is the advantage of organic electronics. There are many advantages, but one of them is lightweight, flexibility, white light emission, if you put some of them together, low cost manufacture, low energy consumption, and so on. So this is commercially available, I think, in Sanyo. I think TV screens out of organic. That's a small historical background of pi-conjugated polymer, actually from 1977 to 2013. Let's go. I didn't have to change fields, you see. In 1981, Ellen Higer came to Brown University and gave us a talk about solitons in transpolyacetylene. And then I came to my advisor. He was Jan Tautz, National Academy of Science. And I told him, look, why don't we do that? Because we have the apparatus to do photo-induced absorption and picosecond, and say, and Jan Tautz at that time was my age. And he looked at me and said, Vali, this is your future, not mine. And so, leave me, I am a morpho silicon. I don't want to change field. And so from then, I went to the Technion and started collaboration with Eitan at that time. And so this was 1981 to 1984. At that time, nonlinear optics in pristine polymers was a big deal. Then 1986, Horowitz from France came out with the idea to make field effect on resistors out of conducting polymers. Then there was two invention out of Kodak by Tang. One is organic light emitting diode, and one the other is organic photovoltaic, and Tang gets a lot of prizes, among them Wolf Prize in Israel, on these two inventions of devices. Then 1990 was the year that the Cambridge group and Richard Friend took this idea and put it in polymers. So now they are polymers, organic light emitting diode. 1994, photo-induced charge transfer in polymers and C60, where you excite exciton and then the exciton separate in the polymer, and C60 as a donor and acceptor were invented, and this started the age of organic photovoltaic. Then 1996 was organic laser by three groups. Among the group was our group here of organic lasers, and it's still going on. A random lasing was invented in 1999, and I had a nice collaboration with Misha about random lasing. 2002, people realized that by using this photo-induced charge transfer, they can do organic photovoltaic much better than was done before. So 2% was a record in organic photovoltaic in 2002, but now the record is 11%. And so I think in about 10 years, organic photovoltaic reached 11%. But if you do it tandem, probably it will be 12 or 13%, like amorphous silicon. Then 2004 was the debut of organic spin tonics, organic spin valve, and 2013, as you see later, is the debut of spin pumping of polymers. You can do it by spin pumping, you don't have to inject spins. Okay, so now spin tonics. I have to give you a dictionary, and so the dictionary, what's electron spin, hole spin, spin 1/2, and if they come together, they form singlet exciton. And this is the spin 0. Triplet excitons, out of those, electron and hole, spin 1. And there are three triplet states. Spin relaxation time is the time during which the prepared spin sense stays put, does not relax. Spin injection is carrier injection, which prefers spin sense. Spin diffusion length is the length, the distance or length, by which the spin carriers diffuse and loses their spins, their direction, and may be very different than carrier diffusion length, you'll see later. And so what is the advantage of going organic spintronics? Because spintronics was not invented by us in 2004, it was invented by, as you see later, by Fert and Grunwald. They got Nobel Prize several years ago. But the advantage of organic spintronics is that the organic have spin, long spin relaxation time, and weak spin orbit coupling, you see later, and weak hyperfine interaction, because the pi electron orbital are perpendicular, and they touch very little the nucleus. They are variable tunnel barrier, of course, the light emission activity, which regular metals do not have, and possibility to engineer all organic spin valve device if you use organic ferromagnet, and this is a speciality of those two people. Then we thought, Jinxi and I, when we started this, to work on a new device, which is called spin organic light emitting diode, and goes like this. In organic light emitting diode, you have two electrodes, one cathode that emits electron, and one anode that emits holes. This is physically, it's not energetic, energetically correct. And if they come together, they form polar ampere and then excitons. But then, because of spin statistics, there are three triplet states and only one singlet state. If there is luminescence only from the singlet state, then you lose 75% of the pairs. And so you don't get any higher efficiency than 25%. But suppose that you can do it with ferromagnets. But suppose that these ferromagnet electrodes inject carriers that are spin aligned. Then one will be spin aligned if the two electrodes are parallel configuration, they give you electrode and hole with spin parallel, and then only triplet exciton will be generated. Under these conditions, there won't be any light. Of course, there will be phosphorescent, but not luminescence. But if you do it anti-parallel, then you form 50% singlet exciton and 50% triplet exciton, and then the singlet will luminesce. So we thought, aha, if we can do a spin valve with two ferromagnets and an active layer in between, we can control the intensity of light. But you can do better, because if a triplet can phosphoresce, say by putting a heavy atom, and here there will be one color, phosphorescence, and here will be a color of phosphorescent and luminescent together that are a different color. So actually, by magnetic field, you would be able to control the organic light emitting diode color, which does not exist now. So we say this actually is a goal, in my opinion, of organic spintronics for this gizmo. Of course, there is a lot of physics to be learned and so on, but from organic optoelectronic point of view, this is what is most important. Okay, how do you do spin-aligned carriers in semiconductors? Well, one possibility is to inject and detect by light, and Brian is the expert in it. So you take gallium arsenide in semiconductors, and you excite electron from the valence band to conduction band, and then when you do it with circularly polarized light, then the electron is spin polarized, and Brian uses it for all kinds of things, to polarize other things, and you can detect it by the same thing, because now the electron can go down and emit light that is circularly polarized. So you see that the excitation and detection are by optics. However, there's another way. You can inject by ferromagnet electrode a carrier with spin-aligned carrier, and then you can detect either electrical by spin valve device that I'll show you in a moment, or by optical. In a moment, I'll show you how. So there are these two ways of injecting, or if you like, forming spin-aligned carrier, optical and injection. But I'll show you later there's a third way by magnons. Okay, so what happens in inorganic semiconductors? In 1997, Avshalom, who is now in the University of Chicago, at that time in Santa Barbara, he uses gallium arsenide, and in gallium arsenide, one ferromagnet was enough, but it had to be epitaxially gone, and then the ferromagnet inject holes that are spin-aligned. You don't need another ferromagnet. The reason is that out of the electron that this electrode injects, the hole will recombine only with the electron with spin opposite. So only one ferromagnet is enough to give you circularly polarized light. It's very convenient, and I think they got like maybe 10% or 20% spin-aligned carrier. However, this scheme does not work in organic. The reason is that there is no spin-orbit coupling or very low in organic, and in addition, the emission is from exciton. Singlet exciton do not remember where they come from, this way or the other way. It does luminesce, and so there is no circularly polarized light unless you put platinum or something like that in the polymer. So we cannot use it. So what can we do? Well, we can do spin valve, and this is the third part of my talk, spin valve devices and their application. Okay, so I want to introduce spin valve by the following things. How do you inject carriers and also detect them by electrically? And one possibility is this spin valve that is like polarizer analyzer in optics. You see, when the two ferromagnets are with magnetization parallel to each other, then the resistance is, low, because the carrier can enter into the other ferromagnet easily. But when they are anti-parallel, then the resistance is high. And so by sweeping the magnetic field, you can change the two ferromagnets to be parallel to each other or anti-parallel to each other, and then you can see it in the resistance. Therefore, this gizmo It's called spin valve. It's like a valve. You can change the resistance high and low. By doing that, you can change the current. So you can read and write by this with this gizmo. Here I want to point out another effect. Suppose that you don't want to sweep the field, but suppose that you have two ferromagnets with that are spin aligned, and this ferromagnet injects spin aligned carrier, but with another perpendicular magnetic field, you can circle or make the spin to lose the directionality. When the spin arrives to the other electrode, they are spin anti-parallel and they cannot fit in. So this is called Hanley effect. You can spin polarize, injecting spin polarized carrier with magnetic field, you can change the resistance with the strength of the magnetic field. Okay, so the spin valve device, there are two ferromagnets, a layer in between, and this is low resistance, this is high resistance. Typically, what commercially available now, two ferromagnets that are metal and metal in between. And those are commercially available. I think IBM has them, Motorola and so on. And for this invention, in 2007, Feld and Grunberg got the Nobel Prize in physics. Now I want to go to dictionary number two. And what is magnetoresistance? Magnetoresistance is the change of the device resistance upon the application of external magnetic field. This is called magnetoresistance. Now there are all kinds of magnetoresistance, giant magnetoresistance. This is where the transport is involved. So you have to have a magnet, you inject one, and then the carrier dribble and get to the other side. This is called giant magnetoresistance. Now there are tunneling magnetoresistance. Now the two ferromagnets are close enough so that the carrier tunnels through the interlayer. This is called tunneling magnetoresistance. Then there is a colossal magnetoresistance. It's huge. Magnetoresistance change more than 100%. I'll tell you how, because you divide by a resistance which is small. So when you call it colossal magnetoresistance, it can be up to 500% or whatever. Depends how you divide it. And so the figure of merit of magnetoresistance for spin valve is this. You measure R parallel, R anti-parallel. This is delta R between parallel and anti-parallel of ferromagnet. And you divide by, I divide by this. But actually, some people divide only by one of them. If it's one that is anti-parallel, sorry, the one that's parallel is very small, then you can get a huge colossal number over 500%. There's a problem. And from all the talks that I give today, I think that this is the most important one. It's called resistance mismatch. How do you inject carriers into semiconductors that are not magnetic? How is it possible? And so those are what is here. Well, before them, you will see later, but those three guys independently came to the conclusion that there's a resistance mismatch between the ferromagnet and the semiconductor, not necessarily organic since, but it goes like this. You don't have to go through it, but if you like, we go later. But since the resistance of the semiconductor does not depend on the magnetic field, but it's very large, and the resistance of the ferromagnet depends on the magnetic field, but they are very small. So how do you want to change the resistance of this sandwich if the main resistance here doesn't depend on the magnetic field? So that's the argument. If you go through and do the calculation of small resistance and large resistance, parallel and anti-parallel, you get to this algebraic term where P is the ability to inject spin-aligned carrier. Alpha is a coefficient, and this coefficient is the resistance of the semiconductor divided by the resistance of the ferromagnet. And since the resistance of semiconductor is huge compared to the resistance of ferromagnet like cobalt, iron, and so on, this alpha parameter is large. If you put it in, it kills the figure of merit. But it's the same argument that I gave you before. So how do you inject carriers into semiconductor? So there are several ways, and I'll go one by one. First of all, you can reduce the resistance mismatch, reduce this parameter alpha. How? Well, one possibility is to do it with ferromagnet semiconductor injectors. That means the injectors are semiconductor, not metal. That's very nice, and then the resistance of all of them will be roughly the same, except that ferromagnet semiconductors stop at 200K. I don't think that there is a semiconductor ferromagnet at room temperature, so it doesn't play a role. So this is done. Also, it's very nice. The other thing is to inject carriers with an electrode with its 100% spin polarization. This is called half-metallic ferromagnet, and I'll introduce you later. Then, whatever happens, if you inject this inject carrier into the semiconductor, they must be spin polarized, because there is 100% spin polarization in the ferromagnet. But there is another way of doing it, by working on the interface between the ferromagnet semiconductor. Say, this is called spin filters. If you put, say, magnesium oxide or whatever that are available to you, that the resistance of which is depends on magnetic field, then you don't care about the semiconductor, because the whole resistance is the resistance is determined by the resistance of the interlayer. So that's one way of doing it. So in inorganic semiconductor, inorganic spintronics, people are search for spin filters like that, that you can put instead of a ferromagnet. Of course, ferromagnet will be very nice, but if you put a metal and a spin filter after the metal, then you don't need ferromagnetism. The spin filter will do the job. Okay. What kind of ferromagnet electrodes are around? And what is the polarization of the Fermi energy? Well, there is iron, ferromagnet, the polarization, however, is only 40%. Curie temperature is high. Cobalt, the minus term doesn't matter too much now, but it's 34%. Nickel, only 23%. But there is one ferromagnet that is half metal. It's called lanthanum strontium magneto oxide, which has roughly 100 spin polarization. It's called half metal. And I want to introduce it to you. This is the difference between regular ferromagnet, like nickel, and lanthanum strontium magnetum oxide. And you see that in nickel, the Fermi energy, actually, it's such that there are both type of carriers, spin up and spin down. One of them called minority carriers. One of them is majority carriers, but it doesn't matter. You don't have complete spin polarization. However, this half metal is such that the two bands of spin up and spin down are so much different in energy that the Fermi energy actually, it's only within one band, say majority. And so when this kind of electrode is done, then it injects 100 spin polarization. Once you have injection from this kind of electrode, then you necessarily have spin polarized carriers. So the way to go is LSMO. Okay. Modera and Miyazaki were the first one to do a spin valve with metallic, and this is the famous paper, I think individually. So this is one of the papers, I think, from Miyazaki, 1995, and you see what's going on with the spin valve. You come here, this is parallel magnetization. Then you change, you spin flip one of magnetization and to be anti-parallel. So the resistance is high. Then you increase the magnetic field, then again, the magnetization are parallel to each other, and the resistance is low. So you see that you have an increase in resistance and decrease in resistance. At that time, 4%, but now they can do, say, 20, 25%. When you come back, it's the other way around, and this is due to hysteresis by the two ferromagnets. And so what can you do with spin valve? You can do MRAM application. You can, by magnetic field, you can have a spin valve in between one bit line and a gigabit line, and then you can, by magnetic field, either increase the current or decrease the current, and this is write mode, this is read mode, And those are gizmos that Motorola and IBM use. So there's some application around. Okay, now organic spin valve made out of LSMO. So this is a story. It's an anecdote, but it's true. 2001 was a guy that we know and appreciate now by the name of Shed. He was at Bell Labs, and he was a scientist, very, very smart scientist. However, he was born probably charlatan. And so he manufactured a lot of data. Among them, organic lasers, field effect transistors, all kind of superb data, but nothing was true. His name was Sean and disappeared. The story, it's a long story how they found out, but they found out that all his data are fraud. So what he says to do with organic spintronics. In 2001, he sent a paper, a manuscript, to Science on organic spin valves, a ferromagnet and one molecule, one layer of molecule in between. And the reviewer was Carlo Tagliani from Bologna. We met in a conference, and he told me, look, I got this referee. But he thinks that injecting chiral, you can get circularly polarized light, but it's impossible because organic cannot give you circularly polarized light. So he found, the reviewer, Tagliani, found that it's impossible, and he rejected the paper. Of course, we discuss it, if it's possible or impossible, but the idea was his. He came with this idea. And so Carlo Tagliani went back, and he was in Bologna, and he talked with Dedieu. At that time, he was doing manganite, and say, why don't we do ourselves? And then they came out with this LSMO that is 100% spin polarized, and they did it at room temperature. And what you see here are two curves, two curves in red and two curves in black, and device was horizontal. Two ferromagnet LSMO and organic in between, say 100 nanometer up to 500 nanometer, and as they saw, magneto resistance. What does it mean? This is IV characteristics of this resistance. So when you change magnetic field, you see that the resistance changes. So they did it as a function of thickness between the two ferromagnets. They plotted and say, aha, this is our proof that there is spin injection into organic. They tried to publish it in tabloids, as Misha said, papers, you know, Nature, Science, and so on, but they couldn't. And at the end, they published it in Solitaire Communication. And the reason is that LSMO at room temperature is not ferromagnet. So this is not a proof of spin injection. And so there was a debut of magnetoresistance, but not spin injection. And so I don't think that this is the debut 2002, but who knows? When prizes will be given, those people will get it probably. Okay, so what is vertical spin valve? Well, you know, so we took LSMO, was supplied from China, now it's supplied by ASHU in material science and engineering. Organic in between, cobalt at that time. And the organic spacer can be all kinds of molecules, fullerene, LQ3, polymers, and so on. The top electron is cobalt, and non-lithography is required. And so this was very nice. So this I took from the Nature paper, that the gizmo, two ferromagnet and organic interlayer in between. That we thought at that time is very nice. I mean, this is LSMO, you can see the LSMO layer, and then the LQ3 layer. This is organic cobalt, and we didn't see at that time any inclusion or extrusion. And so this is the state of the affair. This is the LSMO, this is the cobalt, and you see that Fermi level or work function are roughly the same. So no wonder that you can get a symmetric IV characteristic. However, when then we realized, however, that even so that we don't see any inclusion, maybe that by evaporating cobalt on top of organic, and especially LQ3, which is soft material, there will be some cobalt around for some layer, and we call it ill-defined layer. And so we estimate it to be around 80 nanometers. So if we have a thickness more than 80, say 200 nanometers, so this ill-defined layer doesn't play a big role. And so the coercivity of LSMO and cobalt are such that each of them switch field at a different coercive field. So this is good, because when you sweep magnetic field, you first change the magnetization of LSMO, and then at 200 Gauss, you change the magnetization of the cobalt. So in between, you can have an intermediate layer of magnetic field where the two magnetization are anti-parallel to each other, and then parallel to each other, so you can switch resistance between parallel and anti-parallel. So after several months, we got this curve, which is a giant magnetic resistance, we call it at that time. And you can see that in between 0 and 750, there is a dip in resistance because it's anti-parallel, and then an increase in resistance. This is resistance in kilo. Now, those of you that are, have sharp eyes, you say, wait a moment, you told us when the anti-parallel magnetization, the resistance is high, not low. This is what we got. This is Mother Nature, you know what it, what she is. And we got a low resistance when the two magnetizations are anti-parallel to each other. What can I do? And then high when they are low. So this was a puzzle, but still, you can change the resistance between low and high, which is fine. It was 40% giant magnetic resistance, and it follows the coercive field of the two ferromagnets, which is very nice. So this is the first puzzle. I'll show you later that. Then we change the thickness of the LQ3 between 160 nanometer to 250 nanometer, and the magnetic resistance decreased, say this is 11K, and we fit it with this umbrella equation that was taken from Joulier. It's a very famous spin valve from 1975, and this probably got more than 2,500 quotations, this paper, from Ferd group. No wonder that Ferd got the Nobel Prize. He was a student at that time, and he got this as a graduate student. And so when you do delta R over R, P1 and P2 are the polarization of the electrodes. Lambda S is the spin diffusion length. D naught is the ill-defined layer, and D is the thickness of the LQ3. And we fit it, and we discovered that actually, by fitting it, the spin diffusion length is 45 nanometers. And D naught, the layer, is 85 nanometers, so now we know how we estimate the ill-defined layer. And so at that time, we thought carrier go by hopping, maybe by tunneling, from one ferromagnet to the other. But at that time, we didn't know whether hopping or tunneling will preserve spins. Later on, theoreticians such as Rob Roddy and Misha told us that actually, by hopping and by tunneling, you preserve spin. You don't preserve spin if you stay in the same spot. And let's see how it goes. Temperature dependence. Okay, so at that time, you see that 30K, this is the giant magneto resistance, but however, the other one, it's just magnetic resistance of the LSMO electrode, and we published later a paper about it. But you see that at higher temperature, the giant magnetic resistance goes away, and you have only regular magnetic resistance from the electrode. And so the giant magnetic resistance has this peculiar temperature dependence. We didn't understand it because the LSMO ferromagnet goes this way. So even at 225, the LSMO is still ferromagnet, but at 225, you got zero result. I think that this we understand now, because this curve has nothing to do with the bulk ferromagnetism. This curve has something to do with the surface ferromagnetism, and surface magnetoresistance doesn't have to be to follow the bulk magnetization. Okay, we did it with many other spin valve devices, with many other organic interlayers, and this is one of them, say. And you see how nice is the magnetoresistance. Again, all the time, this is a small resistance when they are anti-parallel, large resistance when they are parallel. If you plot all of them on the same graph, then you see that they follow, all of them follow the same curve, and this probably tells you that the temperature dependent, it doesn't care about the organic in between, it comes from the electrons, not from the organic. Okay, after publishing this paper, as usual, when you publish something that's very new, people want to poke it and to see whether it's correct or not. So we got a lot of slack, whether you don't know what you are doing, you evaporate cobalt at very high temperature, and so it penetrate, and so on. We got a lot of papers. And so, but it's always this, you have the climax and then it goes down, and this is a dance of research. You go two steps forward and immediately 1.5 steps backwards. And then you go something, and then you go to the right and then 2 steps forward. And you can do it very fast, and then you can go call it the science dance. But it's always true. And so it was 1.5 step backward. I don't think that this giant magnetoresistance spin do not travel, they tunnel from the LSMO electrode directly to the cobalt inclusion, so all kind of cobalt molecules there. And so how do you know that you don't have it? Well, I have 250 nanometer. Do you think that cobalt will penetrate 250? Well, in LQC maybe, but in C60 I don't think so. Then, to our surprise, came a paper in 2009. Drew, he came here and gave a colloquium, I think, last year. And they use muon spin rotation. So it's called muon spin rotation for measuring local magnetic field. So they have to go to CERN in Switzerland. They use a muon spin rotation. You can change the energy of the beam, and you can place the muon anywhere you like along the Z direction of the device. So you can scan Z if you like. Now, if you eject carrier from one ferromagnet electrode, the other one doesn't matter too much, but then those carriers, if they are spin aligned, then they have ferromagnetism with them, some spin aligned. So therefore, the local magnetic field, we have not only, stray magnetic field from the electrode and the magnetic field, applied magnetic field, but we have a small local magnetic field that will change with voltage because they put more and more current. And so this is what they did. They measured the local magnetic field along Z direction by measuring and then extract the extra magnetic field due to the voltage. And they found that indeed there is this extra magnetic field due to the injecting of carrier. So this was real proof that carriers with spin aligned carrier are injected into organic. And this will be they found measuring this injecting current or spin current, they found that indeed the spin diffusion length is about 32 nanometer at low temperature. It's close to our 45 nanometer. And this is a temperature dependent of the spin diffusion length. And they found the temperature dependent is very steep. And they didn't know why. This is LQ3. But LQ3 has already aluminum in it. So maybe it's due to spin orbit coupling. They didn't know. OK. So now molecular spin valve. I won't talk about it much, except to give you this picture. Just imagine that I can do single molecule current. If I can do that, of course, this is a cartoon. The cartoon was painted by Vladimir Boltman, at that time a postdoc. And so if you can do that, this is break. Two electrode break, if they are both ferromagnet, and you have an electron in between, then you have an organic spring valve that is single molecule organic spring valve. But it's tough to do it. Some people like Ralph from Cornell think that he has it, but I don't know if it's correct or not. It's very tough to do it. So Boltman and I came out with this idea, why don't we do it as not single molecule, but isolated molecules? How can you do that? Well, if you have two molecules, one of them, which I call, say, conducting, because if they have a very strong sulfur bonding with the electrode, and the other one non-conducting because it had only one sulfur bonding, the other one is not, and you mix them together and make some self-assembled monolayer, then you may have and you do it, say, 10 to minus 4 or 10 to minus 5 conducting polymer on top of a non-conducting molecule, then you have a poor guy way to do an isolated molecule. And we published some papers about not magnetic field, but the IV characteristic of those, the sum in between. If you can do it with, say, two cobalt or cobalt and nickel and so on, then you may have an organic spin valve which is based on isolated molecules, not single molecule, isolated conducting molecule in between. And indeed, Boltman saw something, but then it did not come back. So I still say, tell you, I mean, this was one of the successes of Vladimir. You can see here resistance of some between two ferromagnets, and you can see that again with LSMO, and again the resistance is small when the two ferromagnets are parallel to each other. But this is in some, and it's 80% magnetoresistance. If you, of course, divide it by the magnetoresistance, by the resistance of the antiparallel, then you get 500%, if you like. And this was, not surprise. I mean, it was not surprise. Actually, this was in 2005. We don't publish it. We didn't do anything with it. But the group of Felt in France did the same thing, not with some, but it's very, very, very small cavity with organic and two ferromagnet, and he got 300%, and he published it before us, I think, in 2010 in Nature Physics. So I'm very glad that we saw it before, but with him, but it's only me. So, but now, what can we do with organic molecules, not ferromagnet? So Joel, group and my group joined forces, and I'm very proud of it, and so is Brian probably. And MRSEC brought us together, and we came out with this idea that we don't need actually two ferromagnets. If you put one ferromagnet, organic in between, and a paramagnetic, ion Q3 was paramagnet, actually it can serve as a spin filter. And this is the best result, so far, not the best, but one of the results. And you can see that now everything is correct. The resistance when this antiparallel is up, when it's parallel is down, and we get 0.15. I think that if I'm not mistaken, the record is about 3%, isn't it, Dali?
Yeah.
3%. And so same thing of molecular, iron Q3 acts as spin filter, and then of course we are working on writing it, and of course control experiments. And okay, so I think that I'll skip this. What determines the spin relaxation rate? in organic, is small spin orbit coupling, small hyperfine interaction, spin 1/2 impurities do not exist. So what determines the spin relaxation rate? And so we came out with a clever idea together, and I must, Leonard came out with this idea, with this synthesis of a polymer that instead of hydrogen, you have deuterium on the side. Now deuterium has different hyperfine interaction. This is the definition of hyperfine interaction, A0. So deuterium has a 6 times smaller hyperfine interaction than hydrogen. And we say, okay, if we put spring valve with hydrogen and spring valve with the deuterated polymer, then probably the spring valve will be much better with the deuterated polymer because the hyperfine interaction is small and the spring relaxation time is longer. And this is what we did. So these are two organic spring valves. One is hydrogen, the other one is deuterium. And you can see, sorry, hydrogen and deuterium. And you can see the deuterium, we get 40%. Hydrogen, we got only 2%. And the difference was only replacing hydrogen with deuterium. And so this was published in 2010. And this was proof that hyperfine interaction is very important in organic. Then we measure it as a function of thickness. And we came to the conclusion that it was hydrogen. The spin diffusion length is only 16, while it's about 50 in deuterium. Okay. But then came many, many papers and took that hyperfine mechanism into account. And so these are two papers, magnetoresistance in hybrid organic spin valve with hyperfine interaction, in another paper in 2009, hyperfine interaction, and one of them, and then Misha Rai came to MRSEC, and together with Rob Rondi, they calculated what would be, what is actually behind the Joule-Yer formula of magnetoresistance, and came to the conclusion that Q, this is this exponent, D over the diffusion length, in Joule-Yer formula, it's actually 1 minus PFS, and PFS is the probability of that electron flips its spin over distance d. When they did calculation with this PSS and the hyperfine interaction, and the calculation was done on tunneling or hopping between two sites, and so they allow the spin carrier to hop from site to site, and they did say three sites altogether. They actually found that under center condition, the tunneling magnetoresistance, or giant magnetoresistance, if you like, is negative, not positive. So this, in my opinion, is a fantastic avenue or interpretation why in our magnetoresistance is opposite and regular when antiparallel and parallel. Then I'll skip this spin orbit. I'll go directly to to spin OLED. Okay, remember I told you that our goal was to control the intensity of organic light emitting diode if we put two foreign magnets by external magnetic field. And 2 years ago, I think 1.5 years ago, we succeeded in doing that. Okay, so this is the device that we generated. There is, again, it's DOPPV in between. This is LSMO. LSMO. DOPPV, deuterium, to increase the spin diffusion length, and cobalt. But the cobalt and LSMO are the same log function. So this is not good because then both of them will inject holes. In order to get light, you have to inject electrons and holes together. We found out in the literature that if you put a small interlayer of lithium fluoride, then you increase the Fermi energy of the cobalt in such a way that the effective Fermi energy is close to the LUMO level of the polymer, and then the cobalt will inject electrons. And so the LSMO inject holes, cobalt inject electrons, the electron and hole will meet each other. If they are spin aligned, then they will emit light that is controlled by magnetic field. And this is what we found. We indeed found that when the magnetization of the two electrodes are antiparallel to each other, the amount of electroluminescence can be controlled. Okay, so it's 1%, it's only at low temperature, but still, this is a magnificent proof that actually you inject both electrons and holes that are spin-aligned, otherwise you won't do this, you won't find it. And then we analyze it and so on. I don't want to look into it. The last thing that I want to talk, and this will be probably the future, is spring pumping by ferromagnet spin valve, or by spring waves. You see, in 2006, Saito, at that time was actually very young, assistant professor, as I understand. He came out with the idea that actually, if you you don't have to inject spin-aligned carrier into a semiconductor or whatever, you can do it with spin waves. These are spin waves in a ferromagnet. Spin waves are like any other waves, they are quantized, and the quantum of spin wave is magnum. So if you have spin waves, then they come to the interface between the, say, the metal and the ferromagnet, then by spin torque, they can inject a spin-aligned carrier into the metal. So Saito actually did it in 2010, and very recently, well, this is the explanation, the difference between spin injection by ferromagnet into a non-magnet and spin pumping by magnons into a ferromagnet. So you see that you, in both cases you create a spin current, except that here the spin carrier are connected with carriers, with current. Here the spin carriers are not connected with carriers. So how did you measure that? By spin hole, by inverse spin hole effect, the spin carriers inside the metal or in doped semiconductor will create a Lorentz force, and then actually a hole voltage is perpendicular to the spin current that you can create. And this is ferromagnet resonance of, sorry, ferromagnet. And you see that this creates some kind of inverse spin Hall effect in a semiconductor. This semiconductor in 2013 was P-DOT, PSS, which is an organic semiconductor, heavily doped semiconductor, organic semiconductor. And they published in 2013 CW, it's a CW measure, measurement to pump the spin resonance in the ferromagnet, and you measure voltage perpendicular to the spin current, and this is the voltage that you get. They got 600 nanovolt, which is very small, but still measurable, and they did all kinds of control experiments. They changed the orientation of the magnetic field, and the inverse spin Hall effect changed sign, and all kinds of other experiments. But this is one control experiment. You can see that this signal can change sign by changing orientation. I don't know if the publication is correct or not, but as the proverb in Latin says, if it's not correct, it's presented very nicely. how does it go? If non bene, it's bene provato. If it's not correct, not good, it's proven very nicely. And so, so I don't know if it's because the signal is really very, very small. So we thought maybe we collaborate with Christoph Bohm to make the signal larger. But how can you make the signal larger? Christoph Bohm is expert in time-resolved ESR or time-resolved EDMR, where you can pump the spins in the ferromagnet very hard for a short time. So this is transient. Actually, the logo on Christoph, excuse my French, the logo on Christoph Doe is that CW is crap. It should be also always transient, like he does. But I told you, excuse my French. And so he does it. He did it together with Dali-san and Kip. And this already, well, it's not inorganic, but they saw a very, very nice signal, 3 millivolt, which is millivolt. It's not only optimized even, which is one or two orders of magnitude larger that can be done in CW. And when they change the orientation of magnetic field, they really saw that this signal, which is free of artifacts, other artifacts, that maybe Christoph will give you a talk next year, then this is inverse spin-all effect, which is transient. And this is the future, because this is where the direction where Christoph and I want to go, rather than injecting spin. Okay, so I arrived to the status of organic spin 20, 2014. We have devices with two ferromagnet electrodes. The record obtained that is publishable is 300% in minute organic spin valve. These devices show low field spin valve related giant magnetoresistance response. The spin relaxation in those devices is governed by aquifer interaction. And what governs small molecule with spin orbit coupling is an open question. This can be magnetic memory or spin, organic light emitting diode. In my opinion, the new phenomenon of spin pumping is very intriguing. And I want to really take my time and thank MRSEC for fostering collaboration among various groups at the U of U, and I am proud to be a member of IRG number 2. Thank you.
Why is this pumping by spin waves so important? Is it, why is it so good? Why is it so important? What are you going to do with it if you can't do otherwise?
Okay. you come from Bell Labs and you need applications. But I don't know right now what is application, but the physics of it is very nice. Because time resolve, how is the spin